And they are having an impact on Russia's, that we would actually create a much larger war. The United States has worked very hard to build a global coalition. It is for Ukraine to decide the terms on which it would negotiate a settlement. It really is a question for those EU member states and for Brussels. One person in the world who can tell you when this war will end. The sanctions that the United States, together with its close allies and partners, have put in place against Russia following its brutal and unprovoked invasion of Ukraine on February 24 has been massive. And these are sanctions that are unprecedented. As you know, we were working very closely with allies and partners on putting that package together in the run-up to the invasion so that we were ready to move out as soon as Russia moved. Those sanctions cover Russian financial institutions, things like sanctions on Russia's central bank. We have never put sanctions on a central bank of a G20 country before. We've put them on many other financial institutions in Russia. We are also targeting senior Russian officials, starting with Vladimir Putin on down, Russian elites and their family measures. We are sanctioning Russian defense industry. It is a comprehensive set of sanctions and export controls against Russia. And they are having an impact on Russia's economy. There's no question about that. And we will continue to put sanctions in place as long as Putin continues this unjustified war against Ukraine. Thanks for that question. And as you know, President Zelensky made an impassioned presentation to the U.S. Congress, and he did raise this issue of a no-fly zone or closing the skies. And we understand that request. The reason the United States has not agreed to that is President Biden has been very clear that what we are working to do is end the war in Ukraine. And the concern is that if the United States were to get directly involved in the war, that we would actually create a much larger war that would be extremely dangerous. So the United States has said it will not send combat forces to Ukraine. The United States also believes a NATO-Russia war would be very detrimental to the world. And the problem with the no-fly zone is to enforce it, it would mean that U.S. forces or NATO forces would be shooting down Russian planes, which inevitably would lead to a U.S.-Russia conflict, a NATO-Russia conflict. So that's why we are not pursuing the no-fly zone. That said, we are deeply committed to helping Ukraine defend itself. And so we have been very actively providing Ukraine with weapons that allow it to shoot down those Russian planes. I will say we welcome any and all ideas. So it's always great to hear what our Ukrainian partners are thinking. And of course, it was very moving to hear President Zelensky speak in that very public forum. And as you know, at all levels of government, there's very close coordination with Ukraine. And Secretary Blinken, my immediate boss, speaks very regularly with Foreign Minister Kuleba. And I know I was very happy to see him in person recently. So the United States has worked very hard to build a global coalition to stop the war in Ukraine. Our immediate outreach was to our European partners and allies, and the transatlantic relationship has been the core of that global coalition. But as you saw in our response package, our Asian allies have been particularly important on the sanctions front, but also on export controls. And then you saw in the recent vote in the UN General Assembly, 141 countries in the world vote to condemn Russia's invasion and demand an immediate withdrawal of Russian troops. Only 5 countries voted against that resolution. So we are actively trying to make clear that the world condemns Russia's action. And we hope very much that Vladimir Putin will hear that message and stop this war. So the United States has been consistently saying nothing about Ukraine without Ukraine. We are not going to push Ukraine to make any concessions. It is for Ukraine to decide the terms on which it would negotiate a settlement to this war. We have consistently stood up for Ukraine's sovereignty and its territorial integrity, and the principle that every country has the right to choose its own foreign and security policy. That is as true for Ukraine as it is for every other country in the world. So, no, we are not going to push Ukraine on concessions. Again, we are going to support Ukraine in what it wants to achieve. The United States consistently has supported Ukraine's Euro-Atlantic ambitions, whether that is pursuing EU membership, whether it's pursuing NATO membership. These are choices for Ukraine. And I know Ukraine recently has expressed and emphasized its strong interest in EU membership. I know this has been taken up by the European Union, and the United States is not a member of the European Union, so it really is a question for those EU member states and for Brussels. But the United States will continue to support Ukraine's Euro-Atlantic ambitions. We have been very supportive of the reform agenda that Ukraine was working on before. So there is one person in the world who can tell you when this war will end, and it is Vladimir Putin. Vladimir Putin chose this war. Ukraine did nothing to provoke this war. And it is wrong in every way. So we condemn on a regular basis what Putin is doing in Ukraine. To see Ukrainians die every day because of Putin's war of choice is heartbreaking. So I want every country in this world to call on Vladimir Putin to end this war and stop this killing of innocent Ukrainians. I hope he will hear us, but we have to be clear who is responsible for this war and not only make sure he pays a price for it, but try to create a set of pressures that lead him to end this war soonest.